I have no word from the candidate himself, but these people are wide awake and nobody is heading for the door.
And you're obviously right. They've been through it before. This will be the third time, and I don't know how Ab Mikva's stomach holds up.
It's obviously going to be another canvas.
Oh, boy. Well, we should point out again, we have 37% of the raw vote total in from NES, our collection service, and Vivian reported 92% at the Mikva headquarters. And you have to take that with a grain of salt because they're obviously, although by this time, you know, 92%, they're getting some of the precincts that may not be so favorable to them, but they're making their own poll. And we just have to go with the unofficial, official vote. Fahey?
And we'll return with the latest in just about 30 minutes. Now, back to the network.
Eyewitness news coverage of Election 78 will return in 23 minutes.
Excuse me. Aren't you Robert Young? You really do drink Sanka brandy caffeinated coffee.
Yes, I love the taste. And I feel good that it's 100% real coffee, but doesn't make me nervous or lose sleep.
I know, I drink Sanka brand too.
Why aren't you having it now?
Well,
look, if you enjoy Sanka brand at home, it makes sense to order it out too.
You're right. Waitress, more Sanka brand, please. For both of us.
Sanka brand, the coffee that lets you be your best. Anywhere.
Venture's Houseware sale has everything a kitchen needs and savings everyone can use. Like Wherever's new popcorn popper, popped with hot air, not oil, so there's less calories and mess. Just $21.97. This La Machine food preparation system by Molinex with Blendizer is only $59.88 with a $10 manufacturer's rebate. And Revere cookware, just $39.99 for this 8-piece set this week during Venture's Houseware sale.
Something Venture, something saved. Venture.
How safe is the CTA? Wednesday at 10.
Okay, a couple of very large gentlemen, I guess, and they've won large victories today. Thank you very much, Max. Well, we've shown you quite a few happy faces and some that necessarily had to be rather sad tonight. And we'd like to just quickly give you a bit of a reprise now on some of the winners and some of the losers in the vote of 1978.
I think we won. And I think that it was a great victory, truly. We had a wonderful turnout, and that's the expression of the confidence and the interest of the people of our state in their affairs. And I said before that we've been so honored to serve them all of these years, and it will be my pleasure in these next 4 years to renew our partnership and to get all of our work done.
Given the success of our campaign in getting our message across, the verdict of the voters is clear. For the present, the electorate wants Mr. Bradley's policies rather than mine. But what has proved true in 1978 may not prove true in the politics of the 1980s.
When we were down in the valley, I did not cry, I cried out. And you answered that cry, and you have shown your faith and your confidence. And it has given me great strength to carry on and to conduct this campaign.
I think it's fair to say that Senator Brooke leaves behind some very, very large shoes to be filled. Well, I intend to fill them.
I went through a great experience here, and all of you here were behind me, and all of Pennsylvania, I just wish you, and I'll be working hard for this state, I want all of you to do the same. Thank you.
I have just had a phone conversation with Pete Flaherty, who extended his congratulations on our apparent victory.
Y'all are beautiful.
And that last figure, of course, was Jesse Helms. Barbara, I understand you have Jerry Brown on the line, or were you just talking with him?
Yes, we were.
Jerry Brown, the winner in California.
Jerry Brown, the winner, the governor of California, reelected. Governor Brown, can you hear me?
I can.
Good. Congratulations to you.
Thank you very much.
According to our key precincts, you won very well, 57% to 43%. So we do congratulate you on that. And you have
said... Well, I hope your precincts are right.
Well, we hope they are, too. You and I have different reasons for hoping they're right, but we both do. Now that you have won, you had said earlier, Carter is doing better, and Kennedy is waiting in the wings, and I'm going to lower my expectations. Are you going to do that now, sir, with this large win?
Well, my principal challenge now is to carry forth the real strictures on government that Proposition 13 has mandated. I believe it's the historic mission of the Democratic Party to control inflation and to curb government spending. And in California, that gives me a full job to give all my energy to. And over the next several months and years, that's where my attention will be.
Several months and years. Have you abandoned your possible plans to be president? Can you give us any idea? Mm-hmm.
I've often said I have locked nothing in and I've locked nothing out. Mm-hmm. You asked me where my intentions were, and I'm telling you that my challenge, as I look ahead, is to control government spending in California in a way that is faithful to the principles of the Democratic Party in which I believe. Mm-hmm. Now, what happens in the future? That's an open question. I've often said that the future will take care of itself.
Governor, you have also said recently, people talk so much about your image and you have such a charismatic personality. You said, I don't have an image, I have an essence. Would you tell us what the essence of Jerry Brown is? Some people would like to bottle it and have it themselves.
Well, that stumps me, I have to tell you. I try to see things clearly, and I just say it as I see it. And California, in many ways, is often the first in some of these newer trends, and maybe I'm a part of that. I don't know that I can really give you a fair commentary on what my essence or what my image may happen to be. That really, I leave to you. That's your job. I just, I exist and do things, and you then take a look at it, and then you give your commentary, and that's the way it works.
Governor, are you totally happy with the results of Proposition 13? So many other states have similar propositions.
Am I happy with it?
Yeah. You think it's really working?
It's working so far. Mm-hmm. I opposed it. I thought it went too far, but once given the challenge, I think it is a unique opportunity to actually curtail government spending. For the last 10 years, Democrats and Republicans alike have been saying they're going to cut government. And to the best of my knowledge, that has never been done. And I predict in the year 1979, the unprecedented will occur. California government is going to be cut, but it will be done in a way that is sensitive and human.
Thank you, Governor. We congratulate you again on your win tonight. Governor Jerry Brown of California, reelected. Thank you for being with us, sir.
Thank you, Barbara. Okay. The door is still wide open.
Yes, it is.
Is it not?
He didn't say no, and he didn't say yes.
Let's go to Max Robinson. I'm sorry, in Chicago, he has another winner with him. Max, go ahead.
Ms. Frank, we were telling you that Ed Hirschler, the Democrat in Wyoming, has been reelected governor in that state. We've mentioned that he was 6-7. Well, Governor James Thompson, the Republican, has been reelected in the state of Illinois. He happens to be 6-6, incidentally. Governor, tell me something. Barbara Walters was just talking to Jerry Brown in California about his presidential ambitions concerning his election. You are the first governor in the history of Illinois ever to win re-election by more than 56.7% of the vote. You're winning by almost 60% of the vote. And the last time around, 2 years ago, you won by 64% of the vote. How does that affect your role come 1980 and presidential campaign time?
Max, I don't know. It makes for interesting reading by national political columnists. Doesn't mean much in the Illinois General Assembly. I'd rather trade that margin for a few more Republicans in the State House. I'm one of just a handful of Republican governors, and I'm the Republican governor of the largest state in the nation now. that automatically puts me on the national scene, but I've made no decision to run for the presidency. We've got a lot of work to do here in Illinois. Jerry Brown talked about carrying out the mandate of Proposition 13. We don't have any Proposition 13 in Illinois, but we're going to have tax reform.
Let me ask you one other question. In terms of resurgence of the Republican Party in the Midwest, a lot of moderates are winning tonight. Is that going to affect you on the national scene?
I think that's going to strengthen the Republican Party to see a man like Dick Thornburg, for example, elected governor of Pennsylvania, to see Governor Milliken, Governor Ray reelected. I think the Republican Party is going to come out of this election much stronger than when it went in, no matter what happens in the Congress.
Thank you, Governor Thompson. We have a projection to make that will probably make you happy in the state of Nevada. We are projecting Robert List, the Republican, to be the winner in that race in the state of Nevada. Robert List, who was running against Robert Rose, the Democrat. One of the problems both candidates had, voters could hardly tell them apart. They were both 39, 42 years old, young, names similar, and it was a very difficult race for both of them because the voters constantly got them mixed up. Frank?
Thank you, Max. I think it might be said that Governor Thompson has followed what used to be the traditional route to great fame and political success in this country. He found evildoers and put them in jail. And he jailed a number of Republicans as well as Democrats. We're going to get a report on the status of the House races when we come back. We'll have more on ABC News election coverage of the 78 vote in just a moment.
There's talk your Audi Fox could beat my Corvette.
Oh, you heard about the slalom test.
Let's step outside and settle this.
Even though it holds five people, an Audi Fox beats a Corvette in a slalom test. But that fact does take a little
Charlie.
Getting used to.
Charlie, how could you lose, man?
Hey, man, I did the best I could.
I've been a Summer's Eve woman for a long time, and I never thought they could make it more convenient. But this is new Summer's Eve, the most convenient disposable douche you can buy. Unlike other disposables, this new one-piece unit means there's nothing to assemble. Feeling fresh has never been simpler. New Summer's Eve, the disposable douche used by more women than any other, is now more convenient than any other.
Well, we've just had conversations. Barbara talked with Jerry Brown in California, and Max talked with Jim Thompson in Illinois. But it must be said that there are people in other political offices who are also interested in the presidency, even in the House of Representatives. And I know a good many congressmen who would not like the use of that term even. But to find out just how things are going now in the way the 96th Congress is going to shape up, let's go back to Washington and Howard K. Smith. Howard?
Frank, rather surprisingly, in this age of the liberated woman, the women have not been doing outstandingly well, except in the Senate, where at last there's a woman after Margaret Chase Smith is Nancy Kassebaum. 23 women have been defeated in races tonight. We have two more here now. In New Jersey's 13th Congressional District, Congresswoman Helen Miner, the wife of the former governor of the state, has been declared a loser. And the winner is James Corter, a Republican. In Illinois' 6th Congressional District, Republican Henry J. Hyde has beaten a woman, Jean P. Quinn, I'm sorry. We've talked a lot tonight about Dan Flood, who has won his 16th term in Congress. Dan Flood is one of the most flamboyant members of the House, and let's see more about him. Britt Hume has a kind of political close-up of Dan Flood.
Daniel J. Flood, lawyer, actor, orator, and even now, at age 74, one of the most powerful and colorful men in Congress. His waxed mustache has been twitching since he first came to Washington 33 years ago, and he has played his role here with flair always. Flashy clothes and flamboyant gestures, even a black cape and high hat in hand for a White House dinner. Dan Flood is chairman of the House subcommittees that control the budgets of the two biggest departments in town, health, education, and welfare, and defense. He has enormous power, and through the years, he has never been shy about using it. Dan Flood is from Wilkes-Barre in northeast Pennsylvania, a land of...
We interrupt our network coverage of the election of 78 to introduce a very special guest who's with us here in the studio. a very happy and tired governor-elect James Thompson.
Happy and tired describes it, Fahey. There's no two words to describe it more.
Governor, you've actually been campaigning now for what, 40 months?
40 months. You know, when you get a two-year term, you just don't stop. As soon as I lowered my right hand from the inauguration, I started out campaigning again. So it's been a long campaign trail, but I had a lot of good people help me along the way in the administration and the campaign and my family. It's the only way you can do it, but it's still a physically wearing, demanding job. We did our last fly around yesterday with Chuck Percy, and by the end of it, neither of us could hardly talk, you know, but we wanted to see one more voter, to, especially in his case.
Do you think you can make the adjustment to just being a regular governor?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I can.
Governor, we heard you a moment ago talking with Max Robinson about the fact that you wish you could trade some of your margin for some Republicans in the legislature. But that enormous margin certainly must have some influence on even Democrats down there who realize that you must have a mandate now from the people.
Well, Hugh, it's helpful. And I found in the last session when I won by 1,390,000, you know, just an odd year, that Democrats in the legislature did respect it the first year anyway. And we got a balanced budget. We got along pretty well. It was when we got into the election year and they wanted to give Mike a platform to run on and they wanted to pass some spending bills and put me in the posture of vetoing them for political purposes that we didn't get along so well. But I expect now that the election's over, when they come back this November, and especially when they come back in January, that we'll get along all right again, no matter who's in there, although I'd like to have some more Republican help.
Governor, your proposition is going to pass overwhelmingly. When will you go to the legislature and ask for a constitutional amendment?
This next session. We'll be down there.
In January?
In January. And you've got to remember one thing, though. I'm sure that Representative Totten will have his formula. Chicago Democrats will have a formula. Maybe some Republicans and downstaters will have a formula. Don't take for sure that the Thompson formula, whatever it turns out to be, is going to be the one that's going to pass. But I think by the end of the session,
any proposition will
pass. I think it will, because I think the overwhelming vote for the proposition shows what I've said all along, that the people want a ceiling on spending and taxes. And even some people who didn't believe in it during the campaign, some of the newspapers who said it was not a worthwhile proposition, in the end endorsed it and said, vote yes, we need a limit on spending and taxes in this state. So I'm going to fight hard to get an acceptable formula. We've got actually until 1980 to do it, because it can't go on the ballot as an amendment until 1980. I think it's going to be done. But that's not the only thing that has to be done. We have to get tax reform as well, reform of the process. And I think that'll occupy a good bit of attention next year as well.
Governor, I think both the campaign for the proposition and your personal campaign indicates that the people in Illinois, at least, aren't all that excited about a tax cut as they are about restraining government from spending.
No question about that. You know, we polled during the middle of the summer, maybe early fall, on what would you rather have, a ceiling on taxes and spending or a rebate, which was the Bacalus proposal. And by a margin of about 70 to 20, they said ceiling. Now, people are concerned about taxes in Illinois, yes. But they'd rather see spending held in check. They'd rather see inflation held in check. They'd rather see a balanced budget and then turn their attention to taxes. That's been my priority for the first 2 years, and I think that was vindicated tonight.
Governor, I noticed that in some of your earlier interviews that you made several references to your lieutenant governor, which is splendid. Does that mean he's going to have a more important role in the next 4 years?
Well, I think he's had an important role in the first two, Fahey. It's hard for somebody to be lieutenant governor because the Constitution says the lieutenant governor does what the governor asks him to do. He's been more involved in the budget process here this year. He's been very involved in the corrections process, and I think his role will grow. I'm going to put him into economic development in the next 4 years, bringing new jobs to Illinois and giving new responsibilities. Could I say one word about Mike Bacalus?
Yes, sir.
I was awful mad at him in the last couple weeks of the campaign, as I guess everybody in the state knew. But I saw him on television tonight, and I never heard a more gracious statement from the loser of an election contest. I told Jane, I said, if I had lost tonight, the speech that Mike Bacalus had made was the same one I would have made. And I want him to know, since I haven't had a chance to talk to him yet, that that anger is gone, and I thank him for what he said. And he ran a good race. It got hard at times, but I thought he was one of the most gracious men I've ever heard tonight in losing, and I wanted to tell him that.
It's a very nice statement.
By the way, your wife is in the studio. I just asked her if she'd like to come up here, but I don't think she wants to. I'm not sure why.
Well, she's the far better half of the team. I don't know why she doesn't want to come in.
I think she's your secret
weapon.
Can you
get up here, Jane?
Governor.
She's the not-so-secret weapon.
Why don't you sit down right here? What do you think of this, sir? Let me get a microphone on you, and you can talk to these gentlemen.
Oh, it's much better without the microphone.
Why don't you just hold it? That's good enough.
All right.
What do you think of this whole thing?
Who's watching Samantha?
That was the big question.
That babysitter. Was my biggest problem, and Jim and I decided to get a lady who's been sitting for her once in a while for us to sit for her tonight, and she's being well taken care of and is sleeping. She's the smartest of all of us.
We have to ask you, how do you feel? And I suppose it's kind of superfluous.
We're very happy.
Are you tired? Are you as tired as he is?
I don't think so. He's been working awfully hard for awfully long.
I don't think I've seen him that tired before. He looks like he's crumpled.
Well, I'm sorry. I'm at least wrinkled. But,
wrinkled. That's a better word.
A couple of my friends were elected governor tonight across the country. Pennsylvania, Dick Thornburg and I worked in the Department of Justice together, and I was happy to see that, and Governor Milliken reelected. And Chuck Percy, God bless him. Fahey, you were there when we took off yesterday. And by the end of that, we were both talking to ourselves, and I'm awful proud of that man and the way he came back, and I'm awful glad he's going to be our senator again.
Let's not prolong the agony then. You have other places to go, and certainly a
bed, B-E-D, bed.
But I do want to point out, sort of self-consciously and self-righteously, that we've been on the air for 7 or 8 minutes now. We didn't once ask you about whether you're going to run for the White House in 1980.
God bless you.
And we'll go to commercial right now and be back with more of Election 78.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay.
You expect more from a leader all across this great land. We're a two-grain, lead-free leader. We're the choice of lead-free fuels for your car. Amoco, Amoco, you expect more from a leader.
Well, it's about time, Charlie.
It started out as a quiet trip.
You want me to hit that car head on?
It turned into a nightmare.
I've had it.
Dennis Weaver, on the run from a faceless enemy with 2 tons of deadly weapon, plays a lethal game of cat and mouse. Duel, Wednesday at 3:30 on Channel 7.
One headquarters we've not visited in some time is being manned by Rosemarie Gulley. She is reporting now from Seath headquarters. What's going on there, Rosemarie?
Fahey, behind me, you see reporters who are getting their microphones all set. We've been waiting for, I guess, maybe the last 45 minutes for something to happen here. The Percy headquarters and Percy people may have on their dancing shoes over at the Radisson, but here we're not having truly awake because I think the Seath people seem to think it is still too soon to know. The last thing we heard is 40% of the vote was in, and that was statewide, Fahey and Joel, and at no time was there any indication as to who had the commanding lead. We understand that the candidate, Alex Seath, may be in the building, but then, too, he might not. I don't know when he's going to concede, but as I told you a couple of hours ago, Mr. Seath somehow seems to think, and I don't think he could be entirely wrong at this point, that, you know, it's not all in yet, that there are some votes to come from downstate. And as we heard from Gary South earlier in the evening, they were picking up in Republican strongholds downstate, in Springfield and those areas that... Like I asked him, I said, well, aren't they traditionally Democratic areas? He says, oh, no, they're kind of a configuration, was the word that he used. We don't know what's going to happen, but as I told you, Joel, at exactly 5 o'clock, the evening would be long, and it is long.
Thank you very much, Rosemarie. Richard Day, our researcher, was shaking his head when you said that the Seath people were holding out hope for figures from downstate. I think it should be pointed out, and I'm not totally objective in this, a lot was made out of the fact that Percy made a great comeback. And very little credit was given to Alex R. Seeth for coming from absolutely out of nowhere almost upsetting the incumbent senator of 12 years. Well, we've still got a horse race out in the 10th Congressional District, and Vivian Rosenberg has changed locations, we understand. She's now at the headquarters of Abner Mikva, and I guess they're waiting the arrival of the candidate. Vivian?
That's right, Joel, but the only change in location is I'm standing on top of a chair. We were told that 92% of the vote, that 545 of 546 precincts are in. This according to Mikva's people. And he is leading Mr. Porter by 562 votes. The count that they have is 88,944 for Mikva to 88,382 votes for Mr. Porter. The only precinct that Mikva's people here say is missing is precinct 79 in New Trier. And they also say that Mr. Mikva carried that particular precinct in the last election in 1976 by 76 votes. The candidate, we are told, is on his way to these headquarters. We don't know if he plans to make a statement of victory or just to say, hold off, it's still too close, because as we know, Mr. Porter has not conceded anything or claimed any victory. So we are waiting here for Congressman Mikva. We were told at about 5 after 11 that he was on his way. A cheer has gone up, but I don't see any activity at this point. That may have simply been somebody talking about numbers. We will get to you once he arrives. Back to you.
Thank you, Vivian. We understand, and certainly the cheer was not for this individual. There's Alex Seeth now, and the cheers are for him in defeat. And Rosemarie is there somewhere in that crowd.
He wants to get something so you can see a little better. So if you just want to wait a second. I don't need it for height, but it might help you see a little better. So if you want to wait just a second, we'll get something for me to stand on.
People surrounding him, you can't really see the candidate. They're getting a chair for him. And we are waiting. We've been waiting for this for hours, and we still don't know what it's going to be, but I somehow think that he's about to make his concession speech, gentlemen.
Thanks, friends. Just so there is no misunderstanding, I guess they misunderstood an earlier comment that I made. This is not a concession, it is an update. When there are definitive numbers, I'll be perfectly gracious if that's what's called for. And I want to understand that I'm trying to be gracious. We are giving an update. I want to be fair and accurate. What the numbers are telling us is that we are not doing as well in the Cook County suburbs as I would like. At the present time, it looks like it might be a dead heat in Cook County. In an ordinary race, that would mean that a Democrat would lose. We do, however, have some preliminary, and emphasize preliminary, figures from downstate that are quite encouraging. As you know, I went door to door in every county in the state. My wife and I spent some 14 months visiting many of those counties as much as 12 and 13 times. Now, so that you understand the partial nature of the numbers, I'll just give you a few. There are three counties that we were given final figures on. This is based on a report to State Chairman John Toohey, which he's passed on to us. So we're getting the figures from him, and he in turn is getting them from people downstate. Greene County, he shows final figures, 2684 for Seeth, 2602 for Percy. In Jefferson County, he shows 5104 for me, 4804 for him. In Ogle County, 4674 for me, 5846 for him. I'll continue to read my numbers first, just to give you some ideas. Shelby County, 28 of 36 precincts, 3336 to 2534. Whiteside County, heavily Republican, 30 out of 57, 3285 to 3842. We're losing there. Morgan County, that's Jacksonville, is the principal city, tends to be 3-1 Republican, 14 out of 50 precincts, 1101 to 1175. Adams County, that's Quincy, 20 out of 83, 2021 to 1911. Kane County, Aurora and Elgin, principal cities, 55 out of 240, 5463 to 5281. LaSalle County, 17 out of 124.
See, this is not 18, what we thought it was going to be. Candidate C says it's still a dead heat, and he still is not conceding. At what point? We don't know when he will, but he's still counting on the downstate area. So we are in a holding pattern, and we're hanging tight at Seath headquarters. We'll be back later. Joel and Faye.
Thank you, Rosemarie. And departing from the election news for a moment, a sad story to report in the world of sports. Former heavyweight champion Gene Tunney is dead at the age of 80. He died in a hospital in Greenwich, Connecticut. Gene Tunney, the winner over Jack Dempsey in the famous long count bout at Soldier Field here in Chicago in 1926. Gene Tunney dead tonight at the age of 80. And you knew the Tunney family, didn't you, Joel?
It's such a small world. John Tunney, the former senator from California, was Alex C's roommate at Yale. And for this to happen on this night when all of these factors surrounding Seath and others involved, it just kind of hits me as being more than coincidental. But
right.
It's a sad thing. And, well, enough of that. We'll go on with our coverage from the network and local here at Channel 7 Election Headquarters. Stay with us. We've still got that 10th congressional race and other races to report.
Eyewitness News coverage of Election 78 will return in approximately 23 minutes.
Extra, extra, launch your lay as the selection.
Long has 32 acres of cars and trucks. Choose the car you want. Make a deal on the spot. Drive it home the same day.
Extra, extra, launch your lay. Colors, options, everything.
Take advantage of Long's low, low prices. You can't make a better deal. Then you can right now.
Extra, extra, launch your land grand between York Road and Route 83. Extra, extra.
Latin Hustle, Night Fever, Disco Merengue. Learn the hottest disco steps at home with the Let's Disco Book and Album, the complete disco dance instruction system. Learn freestyle, line, and couples dances with the Let's Disco Book. The album ties it together with professional instruction plus music by the biggest disco stars. So Let's Disco, only $7.95. Now available at these and other fine stores. How safe is the CTA? Wednesday at 10.
And we're grateful to him, and we apologize for reflecting what was not his true and, I must say, very strong showing against an incumbent senator. It doesn't change anything, but we want to make Mr. Jenkins understand that our mistake was just that, an unintentional mistake. Now, I would like to briefly review for you once again the some of the races that we think are very, very important that have been decided tonight. First of all, and as far as the Senate is concerned, in Massachusetts, Ed Brooke, the only black senator in the United States Senate, has been defeated by Paul Tsongas, a Democratic congressman. And in Pennsylvania, the governorship has changed hands. Richard Thornburg, the Republican, takes over from a retiring Democrat, Milton Schaap, but tonight Mr. Thornburg defeated Pete Flaherty, the former mayor of Pittsburgh. That, I guess, comes under the heading of an upset because, at least earlier in the campaign, Flaherty was favored. And Minnesota has a strange story tonight in terms of Democratic farmer labor politics. Minnesota now will have two Republican senators. Rudy Boschwitz defeated incumbent Senator Wendell Anderson, who was the former governor, appointed himself really to take over Walter Mondale's seat when Mondale became vice president. And Anderson now will go back to Minnesota, and Mr. Boschwitz will go to Washington. And in the other Senate seat in Minnesota, the Republican, Mr. Durenberger, defeated Bob Short 65% to 32%. So Minnesota, for the first time in who knows how long, has two Republican senators. And the governor of Minnesota also, I believe, is a race that is of, we don't have a board on that one, but Dick Clark in Iowa, an incumbent Democratic senator who was favored to win re-election, has been defeated tonight by the Republican challenger Jepson, 53% to 47%. Clark was an expert on African affairs, and apparently some of the time that he spent thinking about Africa convinced people in Iowa that he wasn't thinking enough about Iowa. In the state of Michigan, a former Republican leader in the United States Senate, Bob Griffin, has been deposed. He was defeated tonight by Carl Levin, 60% to 40%, according to our figures, although the final tabulations may turn out to be not quite that large. And in Mississippi, we'll have a Republican senator, the first popularly elected Republican senator ever in the state of Mississippi, Thad Cochran, taking advantage of a two-way split between Maurice Stanton and Charles Evers. As you can see, they divided up the vote between them, and Thad Cochran, who is a congressman now, will go to Washington as a member of the United States Senate, taking over the seat being given up by Jim Eastland. There are still some other races that are outstanding, and we would like to just briefly mention those. The Texas race for the United States Senate between John Tower and Congressman Bob Krueger, that is still too close to call at this point, as is the governor's race in Texas between John Hill, the state attorney general, and former Deputy Secretary of Defense William Clements, and the Senate race in Virginia between John Warner, the Republican candidate, and former Attorney General of the state of Virginia, Andrew Miller. Also, the Senate race in West Virginia between Arch Moore, the former Republican governor, making a very strong challenge to long-term incumbent Jennings Randolph. And because of all these races that are still undecided, we are going to stay on till after 1 o'clock in the morning, which will be in about 25 minutes or so, but we're going to stay on after 1 o'clock in the morning, and we want our stations along the line to know that we're going to continue following all these races that are still undecided. We'll have more on ABC News election coverage of the 78th vote in a moment.
Butterball presents
The Spirits of the First Turkey Lovers.
Dost thou smell turkey?
Oh, 'tis beautiful.
Thou cannot judge turkey by the beauty of its skin.
Indeed, it could be dry.
But this is the Butterball turkey, always plump and juicy because it's deep basted where hand basting can't reach.
Look how juicy.
Thou never served so juicy a bird.
Thou never brought home a Butterball.
Butterball from Swift, 'tis truly plump and juicy.
Energy for a stronger America.
Excuse me, Mr. Johnson.
Yeah?
Do you know you're one of America's most valuable energy sources?
I am?
That insulation you're installing isn't only going to save you a lot of money.
Yeah?
It's going to help our country save energy.
So?
So thank you.
You're welcome.
By saving energy, you're helping hold down foreign imports, while companies like Exxon develop other energy sources like coal, nuclear fuel, and solar power. Energy for a strong America.
Let's go to the West Virginia Senate Board. We have something interesting to show you here. Look at this, 99%. No, this is the Virginia Senate, I'm sorry. 99% of the precincts reporting. Warner now has a slight lead, 611,000 to Miller's 608,000. But with 99% of the precincts throughout the entire state of Virginia now reporting, our experts believe this race is still inconclusive, it is still too close to call, and therefore we will not project a winner. Though as you can see, the margin between them is not very great, and there are not very many more votes to be counted. Now, Barbara, I understand that you've been keeping track of some very interesting races involving interesting people tonight.
So many of the people are interesting people tonight, Frank. We had talked before tonight about the possibility that there might be three brothers in the House of Representatives, the Crane brothers. Phil Crane, of course, is the first Republican to announce his candidacy for the presidency, and Phil Crane won again. He'll go back to the House of Representatives. He won in Illinois. His brother Daniel Crane also won in Illinois, but the third brother, David Crane, running in Indiana, was defeated. So we'll have two out of three of the Crane brothers. A very important race in California, and that is Yvonne Braithwaite Burke, who gave up her position in the House of Representatives, a very well-known, very strong representative candidate, to run for state attorney general. If she wins, she will be the first female attorney general in any state. At the moment, she seems to be running behind, but that's a race that a great many people are looking for. Those are early returns, and we don't know yet. We hope to know shortly. And we mentioned a mini ERA, a state ERA bill possible, a referendum in Florida, and that was defeated. That was the third thing that Anita Bryant was working against, and her team won, so to speak. And gambling also in Florida has been defeated, so Atlantic City still reigns supreme, Atlantic City and Las Vegas. We're going to Howard K. Smith now in Washington, right?
Well, Barbara, one woman has been elected to the Senate, the first one since Margaret Chase Smith, so there's one there now, but women are not doing as well in the House of Representatives. In Kansas' second congressional district, Congresswoman Martha Keys, Democrat, two-term Democrat, is adjudged to have lost to Jim Jeffries, a Republican and investment broker. Incidentally, Martha Keys' husband, Andrew Jacobs, in Indianapolis, Indiana, in the 11th congressional district, has won, so he can pay the bills for a while. He's a Democrat. In New York's 9th congressional district, a woman has won. A woman has won a seat that was formerly held by a man. Old James J. Delaney, who is retiring, 77 years of age, has retired, and a Democrat has succeeded him, Geraldine Ferraro, against a man named a Republican, Alfred A. Delibovi, and a third candidate. Altogether, women have 15 have been elected, three are undecided, so if they're undecided all win, they still won't have the 19 they had last time. Britt Hume, what about how are the blacks doing?
Well, Howard, the situation in the House with regard to the blacks looks very much like the situation you just reported with regard to women. Not a single black incumbent has lost tonight. Veteran Philadelphia Democrat Robert Nix did lose in the primary, but he lost to another black, William Gray, who is an apparent winner tonight. Now, Republicans in Connecticut had high hopes for Ben Andrews, the state NAACP chairman. He tried tonight to unseat William Cotter, a veteran Democrat, but Andrews has lost, and two other blacks challenging whites have also lost. So there will be four new black faces in the House, but they all belong to candidates who are replacing other blacks. So it looks like it'll come out to be 15 blacks in the House going into tonight, 15 coming out. Frank?
Thank you very much, Britt. Max Robinson is in Chicago with Senator Percy, and we'll be going to him in just a moment to get Senator Percy's comments on his election victory. We'll have more ABC News election coverage of the 78 vote in a moment.
My name is Halston. I'm known for the clothes I design. And just as clothes dress a woman, carpets should dress your home. That's the challenge I felt in designing these carpets for Karistan, to create something simple, elegant, and livable, not just for today, but for tomorrow. Karistan still weaves carpets, and this ensures the depth and texture, the luxury I want. Now there's a Halston for your floor.
Introducing an incredible new way to watch your weight. The new electronic digital scale by General Electric. Just step on and watch the General Electric digital scale compute your weight electronically. The results come up on the bright, easy-to-read digital display. So if you're into watching your weight very closely, get on the GE electronic digital scale.
Wednesday, Charlie's Angels swing with the singles aboard a luxury liner.
Would you like to see my buried treasure? Oh.
But the party's a killer's trap. Then, a mysterious plane crash and a well-filled bikini add up to more trouble for Dan Tana in Vegas.
I said a moment ago that Senator Percy is in our Chicago election headquarters with Max Robinson, and we are going to go to him, but I know that Senator Percy will not mind waiting for just a moment because Barbara Walters right now is talking to former President Gerald Ford. Barbara?
Yes, we are. Good evening, Mr. President. Thank you for being with us.
How are you, Barbara?
I'm just fine, sir. Well, tell us how you think things are looking. You've got five Republican governors and two Republican senators ahead of where you were. How do things feel to you?
Well, I think we're doing better than I anticipated in some respects. We had a couple of disappointments. I feel very badly about Ed Brooke losing up in Massachusetts. On the other hand, Nancy Kassebaum out in Kansas was a nice surprise. I, of course, was pleased to see that we picked up two Senate seats in Minnesota, and we got a chance, I guess, to win the governorship up there, which would make a big difference in that state, which was so long dominated by the Farm Labor Party up there. The pluses and minuses, I would say, are in our favor at this point, and we still have hopes of doing well in Texas, although we're behind. We'll wait and see how those votes are counted out there.
Mr. President, it has been said that the Republicans are really in pretty bad shape. Do you think that these wins are going to be enough to make them really strong and viable and even powerful?
Barbara, I think we appear to have laid a good foundation for a comeback in the presidential election in 1980. Our support is broad-based in the whole country, not just in any one region. And we've got some fine young candidates coming along in various spots for the House and the Senate and the governorship. So I'm optimistic. A lot of work has to be done, but we're on the way of rebuilding a two-party system in this country.
Does what's happened tonight make any difference in your own plans to run or not run for the presidency? And if not, can you tell us what it's going to take to make you decide?
Well, Barbara, I really haven't had time to focus on the situation in 1980. I've got time and some options, and after we've had an opportunity to analyze the election results, see how the present administration handles inflation and the possibility of economic difficulties down the road, how they handle foreign affairs. Those will be the things that will basically affect my decision for 1980.
Just tell us when you think it's going to be. Can you give us a month?
No, it'll be sometime in 1979.
Uh-huh. We thank you very much, President Ford, for talking with us. Please say hello to Mrs. Ford for us. We appreciate your coming on with us.
Nice to talk to you, Barbara.
Thank you, sir.
Frank, of course, we would have preferred having President Ford on with us face to face, but he is under contract to NBC, and we are pleased that he would come on the phone with us because he's unable to make personal appearances.
That was very nice, and we are grateful to him. Now, I wish to make an important announcement. Earlier tonight, we projected the governor's race in New Hampshire, and we said that Meldrin Thompson, the incumbent governor, was going to be the winner. We are now withdrawing that projection. We are withdrawing the projection of Governor Meldrin Thompson to win re-election, and instead, we are now projecting Hugh Gallon, his Democratic challenger, to be the eventual winner of the race for governor of New Hampshire. Governor Thompson has been, here's the board as you see it, with 61% of the precincts in. It's a 49% to 46% lead for Hugh Gallon, and with former Governor Wesley Powell running as an independent, taking 4%. So we want to set the record straight on that. Earlier, we did project Governor Thompson as the victor in his race to succeed himself and have a fourth term. He is perhaps the most conservative, he would not mind that description, the most conservative governor in the country. And he has now, apparently, according to our analysis and to our key precincts, gone down to defeat at the hands of Hugh Gallon. Hugh Gallon is an automobile dealer who was one of Edmund Muskie's most staunch supporters in 1976. As a matter of fact, he provided the cars for the Muskie campaign to use in that time in 1972 when Muskie was the front runner for the Democratic presidential nomination. So that is a major... Yes, Lou?
One byplay on that New Hampshire race, I think it's very interesting. There was a third candidate, former Governor Wesley Powell, who you might think at first glance was going to take votes from Thompson, but no, he was taking votes from Gallon. His vote virtually collapsed here tonight,
yes,
and that gave Gallon his chance to win. So Powell, who couldn't get re-election, finally got his revenge on Thompson, an intramural Republican fight, and the Democrat is in.
Well, that, of course, may change the entire picture, too, as far as the New Hampshire primary in 1980 is concerned. Without Governor Thompson there, that could spell somewhat ominous news for Ronald Reagan, who was his great favorite. We'll have more ABC News election coverage of the 78 vote in a moment.
Energy for a stronger America.
Today, ships like this are opening vast areas of the ocean for oil exploration. This one's under contract to Exxon, and she's an engineering marvel. Her electronic positioning systems and other special drilling equipment allow us to reach down into waters as deep as 4,000 feet to search for oil. This ship provides Exxon with valuable deep water experience that will help us find more energy for a strong America.
Why did Car and Driver magazine call the Audi 5000 a functional masterpiece and yet one of the most sumptuous cars ever to come out of Germany? Why did Road and Track magazine say, for the money, we don't see anything that can touch it? Test drive the Audi 5000 at your Porsche Audi dealer and find out why.
We've been keeping track of that extremely close Senate race in Virginia between John Warner and Andrew Miller. We want to go now to the Warner headquarters. Warner, we believe, is claiming victory, and that is a claim that we are not yet prepared to support. There is his very famous wife alongside him as Mr. Warner struggles to get the microphone in position. We believe that he is claiming victory, but we want to point out that as far as our analysis goes, it is still really too close to call. Now, we also must point out to you that the Associated Press is calling Warner the apparent winner in the Virginia Senate race. And here's the totals as of now, with almost all the votes counted: 611,725 to 608,457, approximately a 3,000 vote difference. The AP said in Richmond that with just about 100% of the unofficial vote counted, Warner had that slight edge. However, I must say again that ABC News is not yet prepared to make that projection, even though obviously Mr. Warner seems very happy, and so does Mrs. Warner. Now let's go to Max Robinson in Chicago. Max?
We are prepared to make a projection here in Chicago, Frank, on the Alaska Senate race. Republican Senator Ted Stevens is the projected winner in that over Democrat Don Hobbs. That was expected, but Ted Stevens was expected to win easily. He's the GOP whip. Don Hobbs and the Democrats did not mount a very strong campaign, and as a matter of fact, Hobbs is a political unknown in that state. Frank?
Thank you, Max. Thank you very much. Well, I want to just briefly review with you now some rather important developments that have come along here in the last few minutes. To reassert again that we are withdrawing our earlier projection of Governor Meldrum Thompson of New Hampshire as the victor in his race, and we are now projecting Hugh Gallon, the Democratic challenger, to take over the governor's chair in Concord. That will make a major change in New Hampshire politics, not alone in terms of presidential politics, but the people of New Hampshire have become accustomed to having Meldrum Thompson as the governor, and probably will have a difficult time getting used to not having him there. He's a very colorful and controversial man. He is alleged to have at one point advocated arming his National Guard with nuclear weapons. He liked to, he wanted to raise the flag, or lower the flag rather, on Good Friday. And he's done other things that have caused a considerable comment. And apparently now he is going to be retired from public life, at least for the moment, because Hugh Gallon, the automobile dealer in New Hampshire, is going to do what so many others have tried and failed, to unseat Meldrum Thompson as governor of the state of New Hampshire. We have four Senate seats and seven governorships yet to be determined. In the Senate, as far as we're concerned, it is New Hampshire, Texas, Virginia, and West Virginia. And we'll be keeping a very close watch on all of those races. Also, the governorship contest: Kansas, Massachusetts, Texas, Ohio, New Mexico, Alaska, and Hawaii. And that's the national election story at 52 minutes after the hour.
This is Eyewitness News coverage of Election 78, brought to you by Amoco Oil and its local independent Amoco dealers. At Amoco, you expect more from a leader. Now, here's Fahey Flynn and Joel Daly.
There has been a development in the 10th congressional race, and Vivian Rosenberg is on the scene at Mikva headquarters with the latest there. Vivian?
Quantitatively, but qualitatively, I've never had, and we've never had, a sweeter victory than this one. Thank you very, very much.
Well,
Abner Mikva has just claimed victory, and he says it's double of the last time. He
really
says
like
he has won by 403 votes. He's obviously getting used to these close elections, and the more practice he has, the better it is in terms of vote total. He emphasized the fact that his was a personal campaign. He did not run against anything. It was for what government could do, and that he felt that the importance of his individual volunteers and staffers getting out one-to-one to the people of this district and carrying the message, as he himself did, made the big difference. He says he's never had a sweeter victory. I don't know if we have some of the tape of the beginning of his speech when he did claim victory. Hopefully we can get some of that to you now or at a future.
You ought to know, and I want to make sure I don't exaggerate these. I think you ought to know that with the hardest figures that we can get, with one precinct in Glencoe out in Nutrier, which I carried last time, and therefore I would hope I can carry again this time, but with all the other precincts counted and recounted and double counted and triple counted, right. And believe me, we triple counted them. The landslide this year is 403 votes. Hurst and did whatever else was necessary to get
you
all out there.
You could really feel the excitement and enthusiasm in this room as the candidate and now the victor walked in. The crowd just went wild. And he is savoring that victory. He's still talking with the crowd. Congressman Abner Mikva claiming victory by 403 votes in the 10th Congressional District. Back to you.
Thank you, Vivian. Governor Thompson, who was here a short time ago, referring to the 10th Congressional District races and the tradition in that district, said they're a bunch of masochists. We might as well play the numbers game. You've heard the incumbent, Ab Mikva, say that he's winning by 403 votes with only one precinct out. These are the figures we have from Mikva headquarters. You can see how close it is, but the margin is 562, and this is with 545 of 546 precincts in the 10th Congressional District reporting. So it is close, according to the Mikva people. We must qualify that. While at Porter headquarters, and they say they have 93.4% of the vote counted, they come up with these figures, and there's quite a difference. Porter leading by 4,705 votes. So as I say, I think it's accurate to call it a numbers game. And the best thing we can say, Fahey, is that it will be close or is close once again for the third straight time.
There was a rumor that they were going to count the absentee ballots before the night is over.
Well, I understand they're counting them right along with the active ballots of the day. So our suggestion that there will be an avalanche of absentee ballots after the raw vote count that could change things apparently is not true. Precinct people have called us and said they've been counting them right along, so the figures you've been getting include the absentee. We have the latest on the Thompson tax proposition. Certainly no doubt in this case. Yes votes, 595,550. The noes, 137,400. Those are the latest in the numbers game. We're going to talk with our people who've been out on the remotes in the field and talking to the candidates and getting their impressions of the election night coverage, at least from where they were standing and where they were sitting and where they were counting. And we'll also be going down all of the races as we have them, including the latest counts, after we take this time out.
You expect more.
You expect innovative ideas from Amoco. We were a leader in developing lead-free gasoline, the first major brand with two grades of lead-free, the first with premium lead-free. Amoco Premium Lead-Free, proven by experience to help stop engine run-on, to burn smoother, and help stop knock. And even improve mileage because you don't have to change the timing to prevent knock. Amoco Premium Lead-Free.
Of the Knight of the Realm.
Not now. I'm right in the middle of a Rothschild's. So rich.
People are finding new Rothschild candies so rich, nothing else seems to matter. Rothschild's creamy toffee, crunchy butterscotch, and luscious chocolate toffee, all uncommonly rich.
I'm ready, Your Majesty.
Not now. I'm right in the middle of a Rothschild's.
New Rothschild's candies, uncommonly rich.
Well, we're into the wind down, Hugh, and suppose you check us out on the facts we have.
Well, first of all, Fahey, a late result for Lake County, Illinois, and there's a very close sheriff's race up there. Sheriff LaMagdalen, who defeated Pat Clavey 4 years ago, is running for re-election, and he was ahead, but now he's behind. Brown is his Republican opponent, and Brown has 50.99% of the vote, and LaMagdalen has 49.01% of the vote, and that's with 40% of the vote counted. Now, on our boards and our raw totals, first of all, we don't need the votes on Percy and Thompson because we've declared them winners already, and the same with Scott for Attorney General. But there's a very close race in two statewide races tonight. First of all, State Treasurer. Now, Cosentino has a lead on his opponent, Skelton, but that lead happens to fall in Cook County. Now, whether Skelton can overcome that downstate, well, we don't know yet. And the same thing in the race for Comptroller, where Burris has taken a lead in the Cook County totals. Downstate is going to Castle, but whether it's enough downstate margin of victory for Castle to overcome the Cook County total for Burris is, again, something we'll have to wait for a while to find out. Alan Dixon has won again for Secretary of State over Sharon Sharp. Sheriff Elrod is reelected over Donald Mulak. Stanley Cusper is going to be the county clerk again of Cook County. He defeated Virginia Hayter. And Tom Hines will be the new county assessor of Cook County. He defeated Terrell Clark, the former state senator. Rosewell had no trouble whatsoever with Gertson for county treasurer. And Superintendent of Schools, Martwick, the Democrat, will win re-election. And George Dunn will be the county board president. He defeated his old rival, Joe Woods. So, gentlemen, we still have a cliffhanger in the 10th district, sheriff in Lake County, state treasurer, and state controller. So who said this was all over?
I didn't say it was all over, and Alex C. said he's not going to call it all over until he gets some more figures, too. In the meantime, I think it is time for a wrap-up and perhaps an overview, and the people who have been out on the scene, I think, are best qualified to do that. So, if I tell you what, Faye, let's start with the prettiest.
That's great. Right.
How was it, Jay?
Terry Murphy was at the Percy headquarters, and obviously the people there enjoyed the evening.
Of course they did, Joel, but I think the question right now we're concerned about is Rosemary Gully and I talked earlier tonight. She's still at Seat's headquarters, and they want to know just what the Percy camp based their victory speech on. And I talked to a man, Jim Mann, who does independent voter analysis for the Percy camp, and he had said that based on the straw poll prediction of 53%, the early returns had Senator Percy holding at 54%, and they were also winning at least 37% in the Chicago wards, and doing quite well in areas, better in areas than their original benchmark had been set at. In addition to the network projections, that was when the decision was made to come downstairs and make a victory statement. I'm sure the Seat supporters are not very happy about that.
Well, you can understand why they probably want to hang in and get some more figures, but it's really difficult. I can't remember but maybe two instances where the computer has been proven wrong. One was a case in Wisconsin, and one was a case in Ohio when Gilligan actually beat Rhodes. But normally those projections are right, and Richard Day will get to. He seems to think the figures are about right for the race.